We would like to thank Amgen for providing an unrestricted grant to support the IACH webinar series.
Hello, my name is Naval Davar. I'm a faculty in the Department of Leukemia at the MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, Texas. Today, it's a pleasure to speak about immune-based approaches in acute myeloid leukemia, next frontier, as a IACH webinar. I'd like to thank the organizers very much for this invitation, and a pleasure to speak to you all today on this topic. So these are my disclosures, including the research funding and the advisory consultancy disclaimers, as well as that some of these medications may be either in clinical trials or approved in certain regions, but not yet approved in some parts of the world. So to start with, when we talk about immune-based therapies in acute myeloid leukemia, I think one of the first things to realize is that immunotherapy has two major flavors, whether this is acute leukemia or in other diseases. So one is what we call antibody-drug conjugates, where we're using an antibody to target a particular antigen, and the antibody is loaded with a toxin, which could be either a bacterial chemical toxin, and the release of the toxin into the target antigen cell causes death of the cell. So it's still predominantly a cytotoxic cell death approach. The other is where we are harnessing the body's own immune system, whether it's the adaptive or the innate immune system, and trying to generate a immune response against a foreign antigen, in this case, leukemia. And so there are different approaches to do this. This could be to stimulating the T cells, unleashing macrophages or NK cells. And this could be done either through antibody beta-based approaches or through CAR therapies, or through high infusion non-CAR NK cells, and then recently even through potentially vaccine-based approaches. So first to start with, I'm going to talk a little bit about the immune checkpoint-based therapies that work through T cells. And of course, this has been a huge breakthrough in many solid tumors and lymphoma, probably the most impressive advance in the last two decades in the treatment of many, many different solid tumors. And of course, this is why we started trying to develop this in very aggressive and different types of hematological malignancies, including in AML and MDS. Also, there is a huge body of data showing that azacitidine has different modulation effects on the immune system. It seems to preferentially benefit the immune response against cancer by increasing the expression of MHC class antigens, as well as increasing the expression of what could be possible tumor neoantigens such as PREM1, WT1, NY-ESO, and also increases the expression of co-stimulatory T-cell activating immune checkpoint markers. But at the same time, it can also have a dampening effect, and this is quite interesting, through the direct epigenetic modulation of the promoter of PD-1, it can result in increased surface expression of PD-1, PD-L1 on the surface of T cells, which, as we know, is usually a marker of exhaustion and can result in downregulation of T cell activity. And so, of course, this led to the concept that if we could combine the PD-1 inhibitors with the hypomethylating agents, we may continue to have the favorable immune modulating effects of the hypomethylating agents while blocking the upregulation and increased expression of PD-1, PD-L1 on the surface of the T cell. And so that led to many studies that were championed by our group here at MD Anderson, including various combinations of PD-1 inhibitors, nivolumab, pembrolizumab, as well as PD-L1 inhibitors, avelumab, with azacitidine, with intensive chemotherapy in the maintenance setting. The largest of these is probably the study of azacitidine with PD-1 inhibitor nivolumab in relapsed refractory acute myeloid leukemia. This was a study done at MD Anderson. We had a total of 70 patients. Overall, the CR/CRI rate was about 34%, which is better than we would get with single agent HMAs based on historical published data in relapsed refractory AML, where the response rate is about 15-20%. And more importantly, in the early salvage population, where there does seem to be a more preserved T cell repertoire and a immune system that can be leveraged for an anti-AML effect, there did seem to be a signal for improved survival. As you can see, the median survival in salvage one, which was half of the patients, about 35 patients, was 10 and a half months versus 5.5 months for standard HMA-based clinical trial therapies that we looked at our database at MD Anderson. So there may be some signal, but at the end of the day, with the advent of venetoclax, FLT3 inhibitors, IDH inhibitors, and more impressive immune therapy approaches that we will talk about later, such as CD47, NK cell, CAR T cell, this signal was not thought to be sufficient for developing this into registration trials, but it was a proof of concept that there may be a role here for T-cell enhancement-based therapies in early salvage acute myeloid leukemia. Now, in parallel, very interesting data published earlier this year looking at the immune effects or the immune modulation of venetoclax. And this is somewhat counterintuitive. Many people, including myself and others, actually thought that venetoclax may have a T-cell abrogating effect. It may wipe out T-cells, and it may actually antagonize a therapy with immune activating drugs like PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitors. Interestingly, what was seen in this work that was actually done both by the AbbVie Genentech groups as well as Marina Konopleva here at MD Anderson was that although the total T-cell population does seem to be downregulated or reduced in numbers, what's interesting is that there's an enrichment and a shifting in the population towards a T-central memory, T-effector memory preserved population with a decrease in T-regulatory, T-naive, and B-cells. So in fact, venetoclax appears to be shifting the immune system towards a more favorable anti-tumor T-cell immune profile. And this was then confirmed in combination studies in various solid tumor PDX models using various PD-1 inhibitors with venetoclax, where in fact, not only was there no antagonism, but there was actually a signal for synergy, of course, leading to the idea that potentially combining HMA venetoclax and PD-1 inhibitors could be an effective approach going forward. And these studies are being done both here at MD Anderson as well as in other sites in the United States. And we will wait to see if this could be a potential path now for the PD-1, PD-L1 in the future. Now, at the same time, there's a lot of effort in the last 6-7 years that has been ongoing both within our group as well as in other groups to find other more AML or MDS specific immune targets, whether these are on the T cells, whether these are on the surface of the leukemia cells or on the leukemia stem cells, or recently even potentially on macrophages and NK cells. One of the targets that has emerged as being one of at least biological as well as expression high value is TIM-3. And TIM-3 is quite interesting. It's expressed on a high level on the leukemia stem cells. It's also expressed on T cells where it works as a co-inhibitory receptor similar to PD-1, PD-L1. And it also seems to play a role in antibody-dependent cellular phagocytosis, ADCP. And so there could be a three-pronged mechanism of action by using TIM-3 blockade. And one of the drugs that is now in advanced clinical development, both in MDS and AML, is a TIM-3 antibody called sabatolimab. This is some of the phase 1 single-arm data shown from the ongoing study of azacitidine with sabatolimab, where you see that overall response rates are encouraging, not dramatically high as one is seeing with azavenetoclax or azamagrolimab in some of the ongoing MDS studies, but encouraging. But what is really more important is the duration of response, especially in that group of TP53, RUNX1, ASXL1, the bad actors. Here to see a duration of response of 16 plus months is quite impressive. Historically, we would expect a duration of 8 to 9 months in this high-risk bad actor population with HMA alone, or even with HMA venetoclax. So if this is true, the sabatolimab or TIM-3 antibody could have a important role in improving the durability or the depth of response and could be a very good potentiator or addition therapy to AZA, but I think in the future, even to AZA venetoclax or to AZA magrolimab, where this could then add a additional depth and duration factor to the doublet. So now moving on to other immune therapies that are of high interest and seem to be very AML specific and maybe the important ones in future development. TP53 is the area where we're really focusing on developing these immune approaches because really nothing works well. This is a slide just to show that with HMA venetoclax, which about 5 to 6 years ago, we were hoping would work across the board, including TP53 mutated AML based on the early responses. We have now seen and confirmed across 3 studies that that is not the case. On top, you see the phase 1B study where HMA venetoclax gives us a CR/CRI rate of about 57%, which is not bad. But unfortunately, the median survival with TP53 mutated AML was only 5 or 6 months, as opposed to 18 to 19 months in non-TP53 mutated AML. We then conducted a decitabine 10-day venetoclax study at MD Anderson. And the goal of this study was to see if the 10-day decitabine could improve outcomes in general, but really more so in TP53 AML, where there had been previous publications from the WashU group showing the 10-day decitabine may have some specific preferential benefit in the TP53. Unfortunately, even with the 10-day decitabine venetoclax, in spite of seeing, again, a good CR/CRI rate of about 57%, the eventual median survival was still about 5 to 6 months. So we don't think HMA venetoclax has a major activity in TP53. It may have some improvement over azacitidine alone, although even that could be argued. However, it definitely is not going to be the future path for TP53 mutated AML. So what can we do for these patients? So around the same time, about 2-3 years ago, as we were starting to learn that azacitidine may not be a great solution for TP53 mutated AML, we started clinical trials with a group of drugs called CD47 SIRP alpha antibody. So the concept here is very similar to PD-1 or PD-L1 inhibition in T cells, but here the target population is not the T cells, but the innate immune cells called macrophages. And so what we're doing here is by blocking the interaction between CD47 on the surface of tumor cell and SIRP alpha on the surface of macrophages, we are removing the inhibitory signal to the macrophages. The macrophages are then unleashed, and once unleashed, they will attack foreign antigens, which includes tumor cells and leukemia cells. So this concept was developed extensively by Ravi Majeti, Herb Wiseman at Stanford Group, and has now led to clinical trials that we are leading here at MD Anderson, as well as with colleagues at Moffitt and other institutions. So one of the important other factors that we have learned is that unlike PD-1 inhibition, just inhibition of the don't eat me signal through blockade of CD47 SIRP alpha is not sufficient. You need to have a complementary prophagocytic signal or so-called eat me signal in addition. And there are a number of prophagocytic markers that have been identified. These include calreticulin, SLAM7, ELA, and others. And interestingly, azacitidine, but also other intensive chemos seem to increase the prophagocytic markers. So in the combination, you have a component of benefit from each, the antibody blocking the don't eat me signal, and the chemo or azacitidine increasing the prophagocytic signal, leading to synergy. And this is now being done in ongoing numerous clinical trials. This is the largest of those trials. This is a phase 1b2 single arm study with one arm of MDS, one arm in AML. In AML, we especially focused on the TP53 because we saw an early signal both for frequency as well as depth of response that seemed to be very encouraging TP53 AML. In fact, this study is now only in enrolling TP53 mutated AML, which is why you see that is the majority population. Overall response rates were about 63%, which is not bad, a little bit lower than HMA-VEN, which is about 67-70%. But the true CR rate is actually very much in the range with what has been seen with azacitidine, 42% in all AML, and most importantly, 45% in TP53 mutated AML for a true CR rate, which if it holds true would be really quite impressive. Also, importantly, what we see is the responses seem to occur early after one or two cycles, and that the responses do not seem to matter based on what the baseline TP53 variant allele frequency is. And as you can see, most of these patients had a higher TP53 variant allele frequency and were truly TP53 driver AML with a median variant allele frequency of 73%, ranging from 23 to 98%. This is the survival. This is very early, and so I think we do need to see the more mature updates, but we do see a signal here, especially in TP53 mutated AML, for survival of greater than 12 months, but the median follow-up is only 5 months. If this is confirmed with a longer follow-up, this would be probably the best survival we have seen in TP53 mutated AML. But interestingly, even in non-TP53 mutated, older, unfit AML, seeing a median survival of greater than 18 months, which is actually very similar to what has been seen with azacitidine. So we believe that if these data are confirmed with longer follow-up and more patients, then this could be a very important drug, either on its own as an azamagro, or even more importantly, potentially as a combination of azacitidine, venetoclax, magrolimab. That has led to the two approaches to developing magrolimab for registration. One of these is using azamagrolimab doublet and competing against the azaven or intensive chemo. And this would be specifically in the TP53 mutated AML. So this is a mutation selected clinical trial, phase three, the first TP53 phase three trial in AML or MDS, with a primary endpoint of overall survival, as well as a co-primary endpoint of a true CR rate. The study will enroll about 350 patients, open in about 100 plus centers across the world. And interestingly, it will also be the first study that will allow all patients, irrespective of age or fitness, who have TP53 mutated AML to be randomized to receive either azacitidine or investigator choice. And this is because both the investigators, including ourselves and the FDA, believe that TP53 mutated AML does so poorly with intensive chemo or HMA ban, it does not matter. And if azacitidine can truly improve CR rates and survival, it should be the approach to take, irrespective of the age. But this is quite a nice precedence because for the first time, we are developing an age, fitness, agnostic, molecular-based therapeutic approach. And then the other approach here is to use a triple combination of azacitidine, magrolimab. This is what we are developing here at MD Anderson, and IST study is now also being opened in a multicenter phase two study that is being led by Gilead, and eventually will require some form of randomized registration study to show if this can improve over azacitidine. We will be showing our IST data at ASH 2021. And I will say that we so far are very encouraged both by the early response rates and the depth of response, as well as the count recovery. So, of course, there are many other CD47 SIRP alpha antibodies. We think this could be another major field like PD-1 inhibition. There are interesting agents, including TTI-622, ALX-148, lemzoparlimab. We are working with all of these. They have differences in the biology and characteristics. Some are IgG4, some are IgG1, some have very powerful binding to the CD47 and the RBC membrane, which results in the early anemia. Some do not have that characteristic. There may also be differences in the overall molecular weight and the duration and frequency of dosing, and potentially maybe even in the type of responses. And so we do think it's important to evaluate these and try to find the optimal one, or many different ones that could have different preferential benefits or toxicities that can help us select them in particular patient populations. Also, further developing this field is, of course, if we can leverage both the adaptive immune system, the T cell component, and the innate immune system, the macrophage component, together in a bispecific approach, this could give us the most beneficial activity. Of course, we have to be careful and watch for CRS, but if we could get over that, that could be a very effective total immune approach. And there is now a bispecific antibody that will engage T cells through 4-1BB and block CD47 on the cancer cell through a CD47 antibody that is now starting trials in heme malignancy already in solid tumors. And we're very excited about the potential of this dual adaptive immune attack against the AML cells. So moving on now, you know, all of you are very familiar with the major breakthroughs in the last few years with cellular therapies in lymphoid malignancies, diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, acute lymphoblastic leukemia, multiple myeloma are completely being revolutionized in their therapeutic approach with CAR T cells and potentially in the future with CAR NK cells. We are behind 5 to 6 years in AML, but we're starting to identify targets and see some early signals of potential cellular therapies that could also help in the future revolutionize AML. Additionally, one of the things over the last 7-8 years, focusing heavily on immunotherapy myself and the group at MD Anderson, has started to realize is that the T cell component is very dysfunctional in acute myeloid leukemia. It is very difficult to leverage and activate T cells against AML because the AML bone marrow itself is where the T cells are being produced. And often they are dysfunctional from the beginning, either carrying mutations or not being able to be stimulated to produce appropriate cytokines. However, the innate immune component cells, macrophages, NK cells, dendritic cells, seem to be resilient, seem to maintain their functional aspects, which we have looked at in the lab, and seem to be ones that can be leveraged against leukemia, even in the relapse refractory and MRD settings. And so you will see there's a huge pivot and switch for the myeloid malignancies, the MLMDS, towards the innate immune cells, macrophages, NK cell-based, as well as dendritic cell vaccine-based approaches. So among the CAR Ts, there are 3 or 4. All of them are very early. Most of them have less than 12 or 15 patients treated. So it's really hard to make any clear conclusions. The one that I find quite interesting here is the CLL-1 CAR T. This was data shown from a group in China. Here they looked at CLL-1 CAR T in relapsed refractory AML in pediatric population, showing 9 out of 11 responses, with majority of them having MRD negativity. And all 9 patients made it to transplant with a durable response at 1 year in all of those patients. So we're very eager to see the updated data. And also, based on this data, as well as based on other preclinical data, there are now CLL-1 CAR T studies open in the US. We are doing and leading one with the Kite group, and potentially others will also be opening in the near future. So I think this may be a very good target and CAR T that we need to look out for in the future. This is just the updated data that was shown at the ASCO 2021 meeting from the group doing the pediatric CLL1 CAR T in China. And as you can see, most of the CR-MRDs that made a transplant, in fact, all of them seem to have maintained that response long-term, except for one patient who had a mortality from GVHD. So very, very encouraging, and hopefully will show a similar good efficacy and tolerability in adult AML with CLL1 CAR T approaches. The last one, which I think is very unique and novel, but maybe very important, especially in low burden MRD AML setting, is using off-the-shelf, high-volume, multiple-infusion, iPSC-generated, activated NK cells. So these are not CARs, these are NK cells that are generated from pluripotent stem cells, so can be off-the-shelf, given very rapidly, and can be given at very high volumes, 1 to 2 billion cells weekly. And of course, these are modified. The major modification is the presence of a high affinity non-cleavable CD16, but other modifications such as CD38 knockout, endogenous IL-15 are also being done. And the reason we're excited is based on this early but quite significant clinical data that was recently released showing that in the phase one study of this high volume non-CAR off-the-shelf NK cell, 5 out of 12 relapse refractory AML patients, median of 3 prior salvages, achieved a response, including 4 CR/CRI. Therapy was extremely well tolerated. In fact, there was 0 CRS, ICANS, or infusion reaction, which of course is not something we see with bispecifics or CAR T cells. So if this is true, this could be a very safe, effective, and easy approach, even outpatient, that could be given to patients who have low burden disease, AML MRD setting, and could be a very good MRD-directed therapy. And so this study is now being expanded with the next generation compound, FT538, open at many centers in the US, as well as plans to go for MRD-based therapy. There are many different NK approaches that are being looked at, both in AML and in ALL, with different modifications, CAR and non-CAR, both from Fate as well as from many other companies. And I do think that the NK therapies may have the distinct advantage of very muted or lower toxicities in the form of CRS, ICANS compared to CAR T, making them very good assets to use, especially in a maintenance or MRD setting where we want to use drugs that are effective, immunologically active, but do not have major toxicities. And this could be where these drugs fit quite nicely. So in the end, there's a lot of progress happening in AML. This was a review we published recently looking at the future directions of AML. As you can see, most of this is heavily stacked with molecular-directed therapies, venetoclax-based therapies, CPX. However, I think in 5 years, this will change, and I think we will see a lot of immunotherapies. Maybe the first hit will be the TP53 AML, where magrolimab, CD47, SIRP, alpha drugs will hopefully find a path. And then further NK cell, CAR T cells, maybe in minimal residual disease, maintenance setting, or even earlier on in some of the high-risk AML populations could be envisioned. So I think we are very excited about the future of immunotherapy here for AML. And I think the next 5 to 10 years will be critical for developing it in AML, as the last 5 to 10 have been for diffuse large B-cell lymphoma and acute lymphoblastic leukemia immunotherapies. With that, I'm happy to always take any questions related to the immune or other AML-based questions. Feel free to contact me. My email is here. And thank you all very much for listening.